This past week, I had the honor and the privilege of getting ready for our team to hit the ground in Belize, which is, if you're in Central America, if you're like me and you're geographically challenged. Mexico is a boot that comes at a tip. It's right there at the tip. And so we traveled down there. We've been traveling down there for a couple years now. This is our second year, rather, as a church, getting ready to continue the work that's going on there. But let me say this as way of update. I am thrilled about one connection that was made and a previous one, and that is between two local pastors in Belize. One is Pastor Wayne. So if you are a prayer warrior, I would encourage you to pray for Pastor Wayne and Pastor Miguel. They are both raising up men to be pastors themselves. And so in the process of that raising up, we hope that, the hope is that they will begin to send those men to Monkey River Town, Belize, which is a rather memorable name. So Monkey River Town, Belize is where we have been going because there is no religion practiced. There's no ongoing, they're not Muslim, they're not Buddhist, they're not Christian, Catholic, whatever. There's nothing practiced regularly, so we have begun to go in and say, if any place in the Western Hemisphere that God's connected us with needs a church and a Christian presence, it's Monkey River Town, Belize. And so our desire is to see a church raised up. For us, that begins with evangelism. And so that's what we began with last year, is we want to build bridges by serving the people, but with the goal of sharing the message of the gospel of Jesus Christ, so they might have the hope in them that we have in us. Then as we see those believers come together to form a church, then one of the next steps would be leadership. Leadership and someone to preach and teach the gospel. Our hope is that eventually someone from within that community will be raised up to be that leader, to be that pastor, elder, overseer. There would be multiple people raised up. In the short term, though, here's what happened when I was down there. There was the Swindell family was down there right before me, is we both heard the same thing, and that is, we need a pastor. So the people who profess faith in Christ and the baptized are saying, we need somebody to lead us. Help us get somebody to lead us at least once a month. And I know for us, there are times when you wake up in a morning like this when it's rainy, it's dreary, and the thought of getting out and going to church is a little bit cumbersome. If you have been in a position of permanent drought in terms of your church experience, you profess faith in Christ, you're filled with the Holy Spirit, and there's no way to express that in terms of getting together with other believers and hearing the gospel preached and praising God's name through song, there's never that expression that we are intended to be the bride of Christ. You can begin to understand this desperate desire to say, please, help us get a pastor. And so some of these women saying, I want to learn how to teach a Bible study just so we can have something. So here is our push, August this summer, is to continue in the efforts of evangelism, but also to begin demonstrating and teaching. Here's what it looks like to form a church. Because here is our goal as a church. Our goal for Monkey River Town, Belize is that Monkey River Town, Belize doesn't need us. That's our goal. If there's a church established, flourishing, and that does not need an American presence, that can see the gospel effort move forward week in and week out. So our goal is to work ourselves out of a job. That being said, if that appeals to you, so every time I've gone down, I see more to do than we have people or time or resources. But if that appeals to you, I would encourage you. We do have March 24th is a Sunday. That afternoon, evening, before Sunday night service, we will have a meeting about the mission trip. If God has laid on your heart to go, talk to me, between now and March 24th, because on March 24th, you got to be committed. I'm buying airfare the next day. You're going to have a plane ticket with your name on it. So if that interests you, although you may not have been in the meetings up to this point, I do think there's a lot of opportunity there. But our thrust is to see a church established. So more than anything else this morning, would you pray for the men under the leadership of Pastor Wayne and under Pastor Miguel and the believers in Monkey River Town Believes? Because they have a unique opportunity to see God work in their midst. So I'm going to tell you, I'm going to pray for us now a little bit out of context, and we'll jump into our message this morning. Let's pray. Father, we do want to be a part of the works that you have prepared beforehand, the works that you have designed for us to do, but Father, that you also have entrusted us to carry out. And so, Lord, as you have allowed us as a church to make connections both with this village and Belize, but more importantly with these specific people there, Father, I pray that their testimony entering the gates of heaven is that they worshiped together on earth as a picture of what they might do before your throne one day for eternity. Lord, we know that that picture is only made complete through the establishment of a church. So, Father, I ask that you would inspire people in this room not to just be involved in that effort, but that you would inspire them as how they might move that effort forward. And we ask this in your Son's name. Amen. If you've never been on a short-term mission trip like that, they can be very interesting. You never know what you'll run into. And people of all ages have gone with me. I had a lady. She was, I don't know how to say it graciously, of a certain age. Does that sound fair? She was of a certain age, and she showed up. And they began, the children there began saying, "The Queen is here." And I thought, I know what you mean. She's been like that for a long time. But they didn't mean it. They literally thought the Queen was there. And at first it doesn't connect. You know, why do you think she's the Queen? Now the funny thing is, the lady I'm speaking of has a British accent. She's from South Africa. She had gone there as a missionary kid's daughter, and so she had very much the British accent, and she did look like the Queen does now, just maybe a little bit taller. But I thought, that's so odd for them to instantly think Queen. Well, there's two things about Belize. One is it was a British colony, even had a seat in Parliament until recently, and so they do have very strong British influence, all the way down to the fact that if you look at a dollar bill in Belize, the Queen of England is on the front of it. So they're holding up their dollar bill and looking at this lady with her British accent, and she's arrived. Get the carpet. Let's roll it out. And so they just thought that's it. So the British influence is very strong there, and so that still to this day, they like Americans. Americans are cool, but if you're doing it right, you're from London. And so that's how they kind of process things. And it's a good reminder of how widespread that kingdom, right, the Great Britain, the kingdom once was, that it covered the earth. And so one of those figures that kind of understood the kingdom of Great Britain better, I would say, than anyone else was Winston Churchill. He got the idea of what the kingdom was. But Winston Churchill was a politician, but long before he was a politician, he did something that was genuinely unique. Winston Churchill understood what people would value. He got the people in the kingdom. He understood kingdom values. So much so that he escaped from prison. Here's what I mean. Winston Churchill, as a young man, said, "I want to do something that will make me great in this kingdom. Not just great in terms of people, but specifically kingdom greatness." And so he knew that part of that was generally a military conquest, great military victory, or to have been awarded some level of honor because of your participation in the military. So you know one of the places Winston Churchill traveled to? Right next to Belize, Cuba. He went and he fought in the name of the crown in Cuba, and he was considered a good military strategist, and he had done some good things, but it didn't get him the notoriety that he wanted. So when he went back to England, he ran for office, and he was shot down in his first election. And so he didn't get the position that he had hoped for, which history now, we would say, was the best thing that ever happened to the man. Because he said, you know what? If I can't be politically great, I'm going to go back onto the field of battle. So he went as a journalist, this time to South Africa. And in South Africa, he was supposed to be covering the war, but he ended up fighting alongside of Great Britain and the military. He was just kind of became a soldier again. And as he did so, he was captured. He was captured, and he had a moment in jail. A moment that doesn't come too often, I would suspect, to prisoners of war. So after being there for a few months, he sees an opportunity to escape. Now, he admittedly says later on, he either had to take the opportunity right then, go back and get his fellow soldiers that were in prisoner of war camp with him and head out. He took the opportunity. He didn't go back and get anyone. He took the opportunity. And he escaped, somewhat keeping it private that he didn't let the others know that there was a way of escape. But in South Africa, he fled the prison. He gets out. He ultimately goes back to England, and he is amazed at how much notoriety he's gotten from escaping prisoner of war camp. But that really, he said he was amazed, but that's what he'd been striving for. Because he had in his mind something that most other Great Britain citizens didn't have. They could spot what would be valued in the kingdom, or he could rather, better than anyone else. He fundamentally understood kingdom values to such an extent that it drove him to take even radical action at points. So that's where I hope we will land this morning. I think that's the intent of these verses we're going to look at this morning, is simply that. This morning is not about telling you, go do. It's what Jesus is hoping to do is to grasp our hearts with kingdom values, understanding what is valuable, what's not, to such a degree that we begin to act on it. That when we see the chance, we take it. So let's look at it together. Mark chapter 4, verse 21. Mark chapter 4, we'll begin reading in verse 21. And as you find that passage, would you stand together as we read? As a sign of reverence for the Word of God. Mark 4, 21. And he said to them, is a lamp brought in to be put under a basket or under a bed and not on a stand? For nothing is hidden except to be made manifest, nor is anything secret except to come to light. If anyone has ears to hear, let him hear. And he said to them, pay attention to what you hear. With the measure you use it, it will be measured to you, and still more will be added to you. For to the one who has, more will be given, and from the one who has not, even what he has will be taken away. Let's pray. Father, as we see in your word this morning, these principles of this way of understanding kingdom value, I want to pray that we would not simply comprehend it at an intellectual level. Father, would you value in your kingdom. And we ask this in your Son's name. Amen. Please be seated. To be frank with you, taking a passage of Scripture this small, I'm doing something I really dislike. You ever get taken out of context? You said something, but then people ran with it. They took you out of context. I really dislike it because I have children. Children constantly take you out of context. They'll throw the random question. They come, it's Saturday morning, and you're laying in bed, and you have this weird sensation come over you that you're under attack from a fire-breathing dragon. Really, it's your five-year-old this close, just breathing in your face. And you think, oh, I would have taken the dragon. And so, breathing right in your face, and they ask you a million questions. Everything from, can I watch your phone, right? That's now, it used to be, can I watch cartoons? Now it's, can I watch your phone? What do we have for breakfast? Can we have to eat Cheerios again for breakfast? Can we go to the zoo today? And I'll say, hang on. Maybe in a minute. You see what they did? They outsmarted me. They threw in there, can we go to the zoo today? And so I said maybe, which means yes, right? All the parents in the room. That means yes. And so they tricked me. I was saying maybe to, maybe you have to eat the Cheerios again today, right? In my brain, that's as far as I had registered. And they took it with the zoo. I don't even know where you'd have to go for a zoo. I think another state is the closest zoo. And so they said, do we have to go to a zoo? And I said, in their minds, yes. Yeah. So later on in the day, what do they say? They don't say, Daddy, earlier, I asked you about the zoo and outsmarted you when you were asleep. And they don't go through that. They say, Daddy, you promised we would go to the zoo. And I say, then I'm breaking a promise. Right now you're going to see. No, I correct it. No, I didn't promise. And we go through the whole deal. Christians are famous for doing that with the pages of Scripture. We take some tiny little bit of Scripture, and then we make it a promise, or God said, and we hold on to it. We're required of God, and it's inappropriately done. So these passages, this idea, as I'll show you maybe more in a moment, gets abused. To be frank, it gets abused by pastors more than anyone else. That idea that the extent to which you measure it to someone else will be measured back to you gets taken advantage of. So I don't want us to do that. So here's what we have to start with. Mark is taking two ideas in this section of Scripture where he does these parables. Two ideas, and he's hitting these two ideas over and over again. So we should apply those two ideas to this little snippet that we took. So here are the two ideas. First, he is saying Jesus has come to establish or to introduce the kingdom of God. That's the first idea, this kingdom of God idea. Here's why this is crucial. Jesus did not come for your spiritual awakening. That's not why he came. He did not come so that you could have spiritual renewal. Follow me on this. If you've been around church for a while, Jesus primarily did not come so that you could go to heaven one day. He says, first words out of his mouth, Mark chapter 1, verse 15. He came to establish the kingdom of God. He says, the kingdom of God is at hand. Repent, believe in the gospel. He came to establish the kingdom of God. This is bigger than us. This is broader than us. We are a participant in that kingdom, which ultimately, if we are a participant in the kingdom, lands us in the eternal kingdom, heaven, one day. But that's a component of it, not the primary thrust. The thing he has come to do is establish the kingdom of God. So he introduces a new kingdom, a new culture, a new way of life. You would say he introduces a new country. So we have to adopt kingdom life. And follow me on this. Not as tourists, but as locals. So something I was reminded of this week, if you have been around South or Central American countries. They're on island time. You know about island time? That means that they show up whenever they want to show up. That's what that means. And they're fine with showing up then. And as Americans, we go in and we think this is ridiculous. So maybe I break it down a little more. If you've been on vacation, right? You get off your cruise ship in Belize, for example. They were catering to you. They were catering to you. The little trolley to take you off to the Mayan ruins was there on time. They were catering to you. When you go in as a missionary, hopefully you're catering to them. So you have to embrace their culture. Part of their culture, I view as being late. They're going to be late. And even when I try to play it, I'll say, yeah, let's meet for breakfast at 8 a.m. And so I show up at 9 because I've kind of figured this thing out. Kano shows up at 10. Gotcha. And all right, well, he outsmarted me again, just like my 5-year-old. So that, but that idea that you're late, I just thought was rude, right? You're wasting my time. So this past week, a guy who has married this lady from Honduras, he said, man, that's not it. He said, the way they view it, he said, they may take advantage of it, but the way they view it, it would be more rude to cut my conversation short to make sure I'm on time with you than to, what would be better is to spend as much time in your presence as is necessary before I go on to my next appointment. This is because what that says, if I cut it short so I can be on time to the next thing, that's how we operate, right? If I cut you short, I'm saying I value them more than I value you, and I'm already in your presence. So it's a different way of thinking. So we have to think that way. So what it taught me is when I'm in that culture, in that world, it is very rude for me to cut this person off to go on to the next person. What I should do is begin to adopt that way of life. As much as inside of me, it's kind of bothering me and eating me up that I'm not on to the next thing, but I've stopped and I've focused on them because I've entered their culture, their world. Here's what Jesus is saying. He's saying, this is a whole new world I'm introducing. There are going to be parts of it that you're uncomfortable with. There are going to be parts of it that are completely different. It is a different way of viewing money. It is a different way of viewing sexuality. It is a different way of viewing allegiances and trust and how your words come out. It is literally an entirely new country, a new kingdom. He is introducing that. The second thing he's introducing is what makes someone a Jesus follower. Now, here's why he needs to do that. There are crowds and crowds of people flocking to Jesus. They are all claiming Jesus, hoping for a miracle, hoping that when they call on him, he'll answer. I would suggest to you that idea is Southeastern United States. People flocking to Jesus, hoping that when they call on him, he'll answer. Hoping that when they need him, he'll be there to provide some miracle. So in that context, Jesus has to do something. He has to show you the line between who is actually a Jesus follower and who's just part of the crowd that claims to know him. Here's how he shows you the line. It's by the introduction of the kingdom. What does a kingdom presuppose? There's a king. You're actually a Jesus follower. Southeastern United States, you have to hear me. You're actually a Jesus follower if you bow the knee and submit to the king. Romans chapter 10, verse 9 says it this way. Because if you confess with your mouth that Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God has raised him from the dead, you will be saved. Saved, Christian. If you confess Jesus is Lord. Let me show you that. Lord there, some people will say, oh, that meant like Lord as in master of a region or kingly domain. That's not how Paul used it. Paul was a good Jew. He knew what the word Lord meant. Lord meant God. You submit to Jesus as God of your life. So here's what that submission looks like. I ran across this this past week. I think it's very helpful. If you're a knight, speaking of England, you're a knight and you want to show your allegiance to the king, you come and you bow before him. While you're bowing before him, you present your sword. When you present your sword, you're holding the blade, and you present him the hilt or the handle. Then you take it off, and they would bow their head. What that is showing is that not only am I rendering myself defenseless, I am putting my well-being in your hands, up to your will. You want to take my head off in this moment. I'm submitting to that. I am entrusting to you my well-being. Jesus is saying, that is a Christian. That's what it looks like to follow. You submit to the king and you enter his kingdom. So now here's what he does. He takes those two ideas and he puts them together. Here's what we have to see, though. He puts them together with a simple concept, a lamp. He says, is a lamp brought in to be put under a basket in verse 21? Or under a bed? Now, we do weird things with lamps. We put lamps on end tables. We put lamps in a closet where we don't have any light. We do weird things with lamps. They don't mean lamps like you have where it's cha-ching and you turn it on, or you, some of you are, and your lamp comes on. And so, I'm waiting all week to use that one. You don't even laugh. So, you've got your weird lamp. We do weird things with lamps. Their day and age, lamp literally meant an oil-based flame that is intended to illuminate the whole house, and most of their houses would have been primarily one-room dwellings. And so in a one-room dwelling with one light source, any time after dark, you put it up on a stand so it gives maximum light coverage. So here's what he's telling us. What is the lamp? Well, we've been saying these parables are about the kingdom of God. So the kingdom of God should be put on maximum display. On maximum display. If you are faithful to the kingdom, it is evident in any corner of the house. We don't take the kingdom of God in and then kind of slide it to the corner where hopefully those on the other side of the room won't really notice it. It is put on maximum display, ultimate display. We want it to spread as far as possible. So this concept is very simple. How do you put the kingdom of God on maximum display in your life? So we've already said it. By submitting to it as fully as possible. You submit every component of life as faithfully as you possibly can. So we think through the littlest things. How I use my cell phone, what do I do with my kids on my day off, what does it look like to spend retirement years, what does all of those things, we put it before Jesus Christ, bladed us, hilted him, Lord, have your way with it. Every component of life. So it's a maximum display. So rather simple parable in a sense, once we put it in context. But here's the catch for us. Verse 23, after he's explained what might be simple, he says, if anyone has ears to hear, let him hear. So it's not hearing or interpreting. It's how you embrace it. Now, here's why I said that's something we have to follow closely, because Mark is putting two parables together. Look how the next one starts in verse 24. And he said to them, pay attention. If you have ears to hear, and then he's somewhat redundant. Pay attention. Grasp this concept. He wants us to firmly understand and firmly imbibe or embrace this idea of, if you're going to live for the kingdom, it should be a maximum display in your life. He says, so pay attention. Pay attention, because this is the economy of the kingdom. We talked about Winston Churchill understanding the value in the kingdom. He's saying, this is what God values. We know that from the next phrase. Pay attention to what you hear. With the measure you use it, it will be measured to you. Literally in the Greek, he says, with the measure you use it, it will be measured. Measure, measure, measure. So he's using, they would have said that, it's helpful to note that, because they would have said those same terms when measuring grain. Meaning, if you measure somebody and cheat them a little bit in how you pour out your grain, when it comes back to measuring it back to you, it would measure it the same way and they'll cheat you. So be a little bit generous, top them off, and then they'll top you off. So Jesus is playing on that idea of the measuring with the grain, the economy language. And he's applying it to the kingdom. So again, I don't think it's a difficult concept. There's a part that seems illogical, though. When he says, how you measure it out, give to others, it'll be given back to you. For to the one who has, more will be given. And from the one who has not, even what he has will be taken away. Even when he has, how can somebody who has not have stuff taken away? It's going to put it all together. If you're a giver, you will find that it is given back to you multifold. As I read Tim Keller, I think, was helpful this week. He says, so givers have more and more to give. Graspers, keepers, will have less and less to hold on to. So here's the way the kingdom economy works. You take what has been given to you, and as furiously as possible, you give it back out. And when you do, you will have more. Let me maybe try it a couple ways. Teaching is a readily obvious version of it. If you have been in church for a while, and you feel like you understand the Bible and you get it, then you begin to teach. Maybe it's one-on-one at your kitchen table. Maybe it's a Sunday school class. Maybe it's some other group. You begin to teach God's word, and you begin to try to formulate it in a way that you can clearly express it, and you want to share it with others. As you do so, what happens to you? You grasp it in ways you never even would have approached or thought of otherwise. You understand it better, more faithfully, than you ever would have anticipated. Now, I think that happens even on a grand scale. I was thankful that Justin read Colossians 3:16-17 this morning, because I had my notes and we didn't even conspire. We're in separate countries this week, so we didn't even conspire with one another. It was God, I would say, lining it up. So Colossians 3:16 talks about the word of God dwelling in you richly. When does it dwell in you richly? When you sing hymns and psalms and spiritual songs to one another. When you give away the word of God, it comes back to you richly. When we are faithful to sing together, God is doing something by the power of His Spirit in our midst. He's returning it to you. This is, I think, is helpful. Let me talk to just a small minority in the room. You choose not to sing on Sunday morning. I don't know what's going on. Maybe you're embarrassed about your voice. I can relate. And so, my wife will tell you a story. So, you choose not to sing. I've heard pastors come up and try to guilt you into singing. Not here, but in general. You're standing back there not singing. I guess there's not enough love of God in you to want to share it. I don't think that's the route. I've never found that to work. What I do think is taking place is you've misunderstood the values of the kingdom. When we understand the value that God has placed on giving out, and we begin to believe it, we want to give out even the knowledge of God at every turn. So Paul is saying, give it out, sing it, share it with others. I appreciate an author this week who said, if you're too cowardly or too lazy to try to share what knowledge of Jesus you have with other people, it won't grow. It'll diminish. So we share it. Relationships is one that we see it easily. What happens when you try to build friends and relationships for what you can get back out of it? You want them to affirm you, to build up your self-esteem. You feel better when they are down a little bit. You know, you consistently feel empty. There's an emptiness that you seem you can't fill. It comes right back. But when we pour into the lives of others, we give ourselves out. We're there for them to bear up their burdens. We're there to affirm them. We want to see them succeed, and we begin to hope their hopes with them, dream their dreams with them. We feel full, and it comes back in an overwhelming measure back to us. It's the value of the kingdom. Let me give you a last one that's kind of tricky, is money. I alluded to this early on. This is where this passage gets abused. Say, hypothetically, you had some guy in Spartanburg, Greenville, South Carolina, wanting to buy his wife a Ferrari, and he's a pastor. Oh, you don't know about it. Just Google it. So, he wants to do that. What is he going to say? Give me money, you'll get money. Give me money, go check your bank account. I mean, real honest with you, that doesn't work. You could give away all of your money to someone this afternoon, go check your bank account, and it will be lower. You give it all away, it'll be zero, except for the things you forgot haven't hit yet, so it'll be negative. So if you give it all away, it goes away. Here's what I have found, is that when you're generous and you give to help people in need, you seem to be filled back up. And there are times God will even do that miraculously financially. You've given away, it was tight, you gave it away, and he allowed you to recoup that through a gift or something else. In general, though, I think you're filled back up. Maybe you think, that sounds too wishy-washy. What does filled back up mean? Let me take it from the other end of the spectrum, where the Bible lands on money. If you hold on to it, you refuse to give it away, you will ultimately rot your soul for money. The kingdom principle, with which you measure it out, will be measured back to you. When you refuse to measure it out, even what you have will be taken away. Now, we have to be careful, though. This principle can be served in and of itself. You know the shoes where if you buy a pair of shoes, they'll give away a pair of shoes on your behalf and it makes you feel good? Now they've got socks. You buy a pair of socks, they'll give a pair of socks to a homeless shelter. People enter the Peace Corps because of this principle. They know that when they serve people, they enjoy it. That's all very true. But you know what happens? And I was reading a secular author this a few weeks ago. And I think he nailed it. Burnout happens. And then it happens all over the place. You serve and you serve and you serve. And here's what has happened. You have begun to serve that principle of measure it out well, be measured back to you. You've made serving an idol. It can't sustain you. Christian, you will get burnt out in this church or any other. sight of that, of why I'm doing this to begin with, you're going to burn out in this church, you're going to burn out in Peace Corps, you're going to burn out wherever it is. And I've gotten to know you, and I love you, and what I don't want is for this church to be breaking your back in service, to where you burn out because you've served a false god. What I do want is for us to say, I want to yield my life to God as much as I possibly can. And when that He directs me, when He directs me to serve somebody else, I'm going to serve them. But it's because I'm serving Him. When He directs me